Hi, this is Kit and I work for Bedford Girls School in Bedford in England. We're a one-to-one iPad institution and we're currently applying for Apple Distinguished School certification. So my role at the school is digital design creator, which means that I spend most of my days working in iBooks author, creating multi-touch books for the students. And I've just wanted to share a few points from what I've learnt over the past couple of months in creating books for education within the school, rather than creating an iBook for publication of a story or something else, which is what most of the videos I find are about. And I wanted to focus more on some of the challenges that I've faced with creating books for the school. One of which has been the size of the file. The students have iPad minis and obviously they take a lot of video and notes, things like that, and it gets rather full, so we're trying to keep the file size really far down. So my target is to keep it under 20 meg if I can, which means that I have to be a bit more clever in using videos and things like that, and also in optimising my resources that go into the file. However, I'm sure I'll do more dedicated videos to that later. I just wanted to do a quick overview of iBooks author, just in case you're not very familiar with it, so you know what I'm talking about in future videos. So iBooks Author is a free piece of software for Mac. You can only create iBooks on a Mac. It's one of those things that Apple do again, but it's a great piece of software. It's actually really easy to use. So this is iBooks Author. I'm running it on a Mac at home at the moment. I have a Mac at work, which is a bit high performance, so if it's a bit laggy on here, it's more the performance of my own Mac. Down the left hand side is a sidebar which contains all of my pages and all of my little parts of the book that you can use, which include the front cover here, which is this, which I've chosen to do a landscape book, but always the front cover of the book is always portrait going into iBooks. You can then have intro media if you want, but I found that increases my file size tremendously because it just embeds a large video into it. Then you've got table of contents underneath, which will automatically generate itself, but you can customise it a little. You can have one template here to do the table of contents, and these are the sections that are coming up underneath. Then you can have a glossary, which is optional. You don't have to set up a glossary. If you do, it allows you to set up definitions for things and also tap through from the text. And then underneath are a set of pages that I've created. Now the pages are made into chapters, and then you've got sections inside of chapters. You can rearrange chapters and sections, you cannot rearrange individual pages, and also you need to focus on the flow of your book. That's something else that I may do a video on, because initially when I started using iBooks Author, I thought it was all about placing text boxes and I didn't think much about the flow. The flow is actually really important, because up here is a button called Scrolling View. And Scrolling View is an accessibility feature for iBooks Author. It's sometimes easier also for generally for people to read. What happens is that most of the time your pages are laid out in your template, whether you pick landscape or portrait. And then that gives you loads of control over how it looks on each individual page. So if I do a foot page there, you can see that it's in a two column layout and that it flows from page to page. However, you can't increase the font size on the iPad, you can't zoom in on the font size. Now I've got to think carefully about students with visual impairments. Think about people who do struggle to look at things on an iPad, they may need things enlarged. The only way of doing that in iBooks Author is to use Scrolling View. Scrolling View changes the way that the page is laid out entirely, and it becomes a long scrolling page. iBooks Author gives you an impression of how that looks, but you really need to test it on the iPad as well to be sure. That is why the flow of the page is really important, because if you place text boxes, it doesn't appear in Scrolling View. It doesn't know to link from one to the other. So that's the sidebar. There is also a top bit here, hidden, which is your master layouts. I'll do another video to show you how to use those and set up a template. Across the top is a toolbar that gives you the ability to add different types of pages. There's a shortcut there. Change the view of the sidebar to show book outline or page thumbnails. There's also options to show glossary toolbar to show and hide the styles drawer. Now the styles drawer comes out on the left hand side here outside of the window. So if you're using maximum size of your monitor because you're on a MacBook, be aware of that because I didn't twig straight away. that's also toggled there. You've got the option to show the layouts, which will open this part here, to hide the format bar and show the format bar, to show rulers if you need those, and to show the layout boundaries. That's what shows on there, they're on there and there, and to also show invisibles. You've also got the scrolling view, which I just toggled a minute ago. The text boxes, show these text boxes here, to draw text boxes, a shape menu to draw different types of shapes. There we go, my Mac's struggling now. Table and the different types of charts, which I haven't admittedly used so much yet. And a set of standard widgets, gallery, which allows you to put photo gallery, media, which is to embed video, review, which is a little non-submitting self-assessment with multiple choice questions. Keynote allows you to embed Keynote. Interactive image allows you to label up an image and zoom in and out of it with the labels. 3D allows you to embed collider files. Scrolling sidebar, I feel is a bit naff, but it allows you to create a fixed height and width area that will scroll up and down. Popovers, they're quite fun sometimes to label up things. It allows you to, when you add it, creates an image which you then have a pop-up bubble. So when you tap that image, it opens. And HTML allows you to embed some simple HTML into it as well. You've also got a preview button here, which gives you the option of previewing your book in iBooks on the Mac. If you plug an iPad in, it will also show the iPad. It creates a proof and it gives you an impression of what the book is going to look like in iBooks. Still, I would really advise you to test it on an iPad to export it and import it into iBooks on your iPad. You can do that by syncing it up with iTunes on the Mac. There is also the option to publish if you want to publish the book, but I won't go that far yet. Then the inspector window, which is here, it's toggled from this button here. The inspector window is really important because it shows lots of different things in there. And I think I'll probably put a video all on its own just about the inspector window because there's so much in there. Then you've got the option of a media library, which I don't tend to use if I'm honest. I tend to go through different methods of dragging things in. And colours, so you can set up your palettes as you can with other ones here. Because I'm at home, I haven't got mine set up, but at work I've got a whole different palette set up for different templates and also the school branding. And then finally the fonts in there. So that's an overview of the iBooks author software, which is free and available on the App Store. My name is Kit and I work for Bedford Girls School and I'm the digital design creator, and this is one of my first videos that I'm creating to go through how iBooks author works. Thanks.